from a manuscript I'm working on. It's about an old guy who just lost his wife. When he stood chest deep in the surf, stoically enduring an oncoming set of waves as they washed over his body. When the waves passed, he raised his arms in a last declaration, as if he had been speaking to the great ocean for some time but had not been heard. The ocean tonight was wet from his cries, and he bobbled up and down the waves like a severed and lost buoy. Charlie took a seat in a wooden lounger. He didn't want to disrupt the unreserved and sorrowfully romantic moment. When one speaks to the world around them, it's usually an ominous call. To call for rescue is as old as time. It is a just and fair expression of doubt. Charlie closed his eyes. It was a while until Whitney came in from the ocean, the black abyss becoming gently hued with the rising sun. Whitney noticed him on the patio and came up from the shore. What are you doing here, Charlie? Came to check on you. Haven't seen you since. That was only a day ago. I guess I'm used to seeing you every day, Charlie replied. Couldn't sleep anyways. When he looked at him, well, come on in. Spot a breakfast? Would love some, Charlie responded. Whitney slapped Charlie's knee and headed in. Charlie sat down at the breakfast bar watching Whitney cook. No words were said for a long time. When breakfast was ready, they moved to a table by the window. Looks good, Charlie said. Whitney sadly nodded. You okay, Whitney? Charlie asked. Whitney placed his fork down. What are you, the town clerk, besides my bartender? Before today I felt so, but now I just feel full of shit for some reason, Charlie said. I serve more than wine, if that's all you want from the pub clerk, but fuck it, I'm here now. Whitney couldn't help but produce a smile. I'm getting old, Charlie, I've told you that. And between you and me, I don't feel like being here anymore. What is making you feel like that, Charlie gently asked. Like my dream, Whitney said. I'm losing everything. My body is broken, my mind is fading. My kids want to drive me everywhere and think they know what's best for me. Every day the doctor says I need to quit doing this, and I need to take more of that. Whitney took a long breath. Mostly though, Charlie, I miss my wife, my beautiful wife. I no longer see her clearly. My memory of her grows fainter and fainter every day I stay here. She seems like a dream from a lifetime ago. Soon I'm afraid it will feel like she didn't even exist. Whitney paused, looking at a set of photos on the wall behind Charlie. Charlie turned and looked at them too. They were of Whitney and his wife, the years, the travels, their special moments, their love. Whitney smacked the table. You know, Charlie, I did my time. I was a good person. I raised an honest family and I watched them grow and have feelings of their own. I broke my back and worked hard for everything I've ever had. Now I want out. I want to end it. I did what I came here to do. Whitney said, teary-eyed. Bet you think that's selfish, don't you? Charlie looked gently at him for a moment. No, he said. I never agreed with that suicide is selfish bullshit. In fact, I think the opposite. Whitney scoffed. No, seriously, I think the person who says it's wrong is a selfish one. Whitney looked puzzled and sat back. Whitney, when I was in high school, I used to work as a swing driver for UPS during the Christmas season. There was a girl in my grade who had a sister who was a few years younger. Well, her sister killed herself. I didn't know it at the time, but the uncle of the two girls was the driver of the truck I was working for. He asked me if I had heard about it, and I said I did. He told me it was a selfish act, and that she left her family behind and brought her to her friends and loved ones. I told him I thought he was selfish. He almost punched me right in the face, but pushed me off as another stupid kid. Look here, you have this girl struggling every day. She's trying to make the best out of it and probably doesn't even understand or know why she feels this way. But every day to her is like hell, like being stabbed over and over again. In traffic, she hopes for a head-on collision. Standing in the line at the bank, she hopes for a murderous robbery. Alone, a slip and fall in the bathtub, a warm delight from that. Anything to escape hurting anymore. Anything to escape another crackpot doctor giving her more drugs, making her feel nothing at all. A robot with a mental meat wall to be fucked and fucked again without satisfaction. And all this asshole can say is he wished she were here and suffered every day so her and her family wouldn't have to, like a savior suffering and dying for someone else's sins because they couldn't do it themselves. It reminds me of an old dog that the owner just won't put down. The parent with the child on life support doesn't pull the plug. The person who is dying from painful terminal cancer and is forced to suffer mercilessly before they are allowed to die. That is fucking selfish. I think if you don't want to be here, then it's your choice. It shouldn't be against the law. How is the law? How is that even law? Charlie threw his hands up. Fuck the law. The law is selfish. How can anyone tell you what you can and can't do with your body? Whitney began weeping. He got up from the breakfast table and walked to another room. Charlie remained at the table and felt bad. Had he said the wrong thing? He wondered. Should he have just kept his opinions to himself? Whitney returned carrying a small box. He dropped it on the table in front of Charlie. I'm a Catholic, he said. Will you help me do it? Charlie looked down at the black box, unsure of what was inside. He opened it slightly, revealing a handgun. Will you load it, Charlie? Will you help me pull the trigger? A burning sensation ran through Charlie's limbs, ending in his head. Are you serious? Charlie choked up a cough as his heart thumped in his throat. When he got down to one knee, talking closely to Charlie. Please, Charlie, will you help me? I want to see my wife again. Charlie opened the box all the way and stared at it. He became nauseous as a dizzy feeling raced up his spine to the base of his skull. Charlie realized he wasn't one of John Ronson's psychopaths, his earlier ramble now exploding with the charged black powder cartridges next to the gun. It revealed an unseen avalanche as his once steady stance on hospitality killing now began tilting on its axis toward a violent polar shift. Winnie walked to the cabin, grabbing a bottle of scotch. "I've been saving this for the right occasion." Charlie watched as he grabbed two tulip chip glasses and poured. "Load the gun, Charlie." Charlie did as he was told. Charlie had loaded a gun before, but his hand shook with trepidation. There were two empty clips, and Charlie began pushing bullets in. It took more force than he remembered. The skin under his thumbnail flushed red. He injected the clip, the butt of the gun sagging like the fat stripper's ass he had seen last week. "Charlie, we only need one bullet," Whitney laughed, taking a swig. Charlie half smiled and nodded.
That's...
Joseph, everyone.